Come join me on my second channel, Jaguar Gator 8, where we'll talk all things college football. New video drops every Monday at 6 p.m. Eastern. Click the card in the upper right corner to watch the latest video. And now, on with our feature presentation. When you're only 50 miles away from a city that has an NFL team, and you're an hour out, provided that the game doesn't get blacked out, it's natural to expect that the local TV affiliate will show your team's games. If you live in San Jose, you expect to be able to watch the 49ers. If you live in Olympia, you expect to be able to watch the Seahawks. If you live in Boca Raton, you expect to be able to watch the Dolphins. You get the idea. Secondary markets are a critical part of the NFL. And typically, if you're in a city that is within 75 miles of an NFL city, you are in a secondary market. If you're in a city that's within 50 miles, you're definitely in a secondary market, and you're going to be able to watch all of your team's games. That is, most of the time. Because in 1989, there was an absolutely bizarre controversy involving the city of Dayton, Ohio, and their inability to watch the Cincinnati Bengals play. In 1989, the NBC affiliate, Channel 22, was in a pickle, and they were going to make people outraged no matter what they did. But the way that Channel 22 came to the decision that they did is absolutely bizarre. Because this is a prime lesson that sometimes bullying works, and sometimes the loud minority can get their way over the silent majority. This is the story behind the craziest broadcasting controversy between NBC and the Cincinnati Bengals. Before I talk about the incident in question, we need some context to understand how the schedule was designed, and what the issue was. It's November 5th, 1989, and there are some big games on the schedule for Week 9 as we head to the halfway point of the final season of the decade. One of these big games featured none other than the Cincinnati Bengals, as at 4 o'clock, they were going to be on the road against the Los Angeles Raiders. And at least when it came to the games taking place in the AFC, this might have been the biggest one of the week. In one corner, the Cincinnati Bengals were 5-3. They were the defending conference champion, and were coming off of a convincing victory the week before against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, where they won 56-23 in a game that somehow would not be the most points that Cincy would wind up scoring in a game all season. They have the second best offense in the conference, only behind the Buffalo Bills. They have the second highest point differential in the conference, only behind the Cleveland Browns, and they needed to win this game, because the AFC Central was jammed tight, with the Browns at 5-3, and the Oilers and Steelers right behind at 4-4. There was very little room for error in that division, especially when you're playing a team like the Raiders. And speaking of the Raiders, they were 4-4 and also right in the thick of things for a playoff spot, as they were tied with 5 other teams for the final wild card. This was expected to be a super close game, with the Bengals only being favored by 2 points, so a bunch of people were looking forward to this one. For all intents and purposes, this was the biggest game on NBC's lineup that day. However, in the state of Ohio, this game posed some problems, because at 1 o'clock, you had the other 5-3 team in the AFC Central playing, who also happened to be from Ohio. At 1 o'clock, the Cleveland Browns were traveling down to Tampa Bay to take on the Buccaneers. And this was a big game as well, with a lot of meaning, not just for Tampa Bay, who entered at 3-5 and needed to win this game to have any shot at keeping their season alive in the ultra-competitive NFC, but for Cleveland as well, who wanted this game for the same exact reasons that Cincinnati wanted their game, as they were in the same exact scenario. Cleveland actually entered this game with a point differential of plus 79, which was the best in all of football, and they had a swarming defense that allowed just 112 points through the first 8 games, coming out to an average of 14 points per game, which was the best average in the league. In other words, the Browns were really good. Now, the good news for NBC, and for football fans in Ohio, was that NBC had a doubleheader, and fans in Dayton would be able to watch both games. They'd be able to see the Browns play at 1 o'clock, and the Bengals play at 4 o'clock. So regardless of what team you were a fan of, you would get to see the action. Here's where the problem comes in, since both games were on NBC. The Browns played at 1 o'clock, and the Bengals played at 4 o'clock. And the pace of play in 1989 was a huge issue. Games never ran under 3 hours. The average length of a game through the first half of 1989 was a whopping 3 hours and 9 minutes. As one writer said on this, the chances of the Brownies wrapping it up by 4 are about equal to the probability it will be snowing in Tampa. With that in mind, if the 1 o'clock game ran over, what would the NBC affiliate in Dayton, Channel 22, do about it? Well, there was an NFL rule back then that still exists today regarding how to handle secondary markets if your team is playing in the later game and the earlier game runs over. Per NFL rules, if the team in your market is playing the late game, and the game before that is between two teams in a different market, regardless of what's happening in the earlier game, you had to switch to the later game to show your local team. Didn't matter if the other game was in overtime or was coming down to the wire. You would never miss a snap of the local team. We've seen that controversy many times before. Heck, we saw it this past season, where New York didn't get to see the endings of the Packers-Bengals overtime game because the Giants were getting ready to kick off on Fox. And because of this rule, the decision was easy. Yes, it was going to cause controversy no matter what, but Channel 22 was bound to show the Bengals game. If the Browns game was running long, then they had to flip it to the Bengals game. Dayton is a secondary market of Cincinnati, not Cleveland. Dayton is about 50 miles away from Cincinnati and about 210 miles away from Cleveland, so it's four times closer. It's not like this is a city at the midway point we're talking about here. The NBC affiliate had to show every snap of the Bengals game, and they had to flip away from the Browns game. They even had an announcement prepared for the inevitable, with the announcement reading that due to contractual issues, they had to leave the Browns game to join the start of the Bengals game. So this whole situation stinks, and it's incredibly unfortunate, but it's just one of the harsh realities of the schedule. Sometimes, you get weird situations like this, where you're bound to make someone upset. And if that was the end of our story, then it's not really much of a story. But here's where the controversy comes in. Because in essence, Browns fans forced the station's hand. You're not going to show the end of our game? Fine. We're going to make your life a living hell. And that's where things go completely off the rails. The moment it was announced earlier in the week that due to NFL broadcast rules, that Channel 22 would have to flip over from the Browns game to the Bengals game, Browns fans decided to make everyone's life at NBC miserable. Because Browns fans organized a campaign to disrupt business so much that NBC would be forced to show the conclusion of the game, even though it would go against NFL rules. On Tuesday, October 31st, Browns fans spent their Halloween calling into NBC, flooding the phone lines to voice their concern. And they didn't stop all day and night. They called on November 1st and November 2nd as well. And I'm not talking about a few angry people who wanted to make their voices heard. There were so many calls that the switchboard was so flooded that NBC literally could not do regular business. Seriously, the people working the switchboard at NBC were just trying to go about their lives, and Browns fans bombarded them so much that it was impossible for them to do their job. They kept calling throughout the week, saying that Channel 22 should be tied with the Browns and not the Bengals, and they were able to convince the people in New York, which is where the choice was ultimately decided, that Dayton was a Browns market. Obviously, if you're a Bengals fan, you're not calling up NBC thanking them for showing your game. Most people don't email the manager of a company if they have good service. You email if you've been inconvenienced and you don't get what you want. Whether Dayton was Browns country or Bengals country back in 1989, I'm not sure. But after all of those phone calls, and after three straight days of the switchboards being flooded to the point where NBC officials could not do their jobs, NBC decided that Channel 22 was going to call an audible. If the Browns game was within 17 points, then they'd stay with it until the end. If it was outside of 17 points, so a blowout in either direction, they would flip it to the start of the Bengals game. Either way, Channel 22 was ready for a firestorm. Sandy Patton, the promotion director for Channel 22, said you're going to make 50% of the people mad, whichever way you go. They were so ready that they went over protocol in the days leading up to the game with their employees, having two extra people coming in that day to take phone calls. Instead of two people manning the phones like usual, it was four. They were trying to get ready for this. But again, this whole thing could be a complete non-issue if the Browns game takes under 3 hours to complete. A quick game, and this is much ado about nothing, and both fan bases will be happy and will get to see their whole games. Just can't have anything like a long delay happen, and we're good to go.
Thane Gash, number 30, who ran back the last interception for a touchdown. It's down on the field right now.
He made the tackle on Hill, blasted into him, and I think injured his right shoulder.
Well, let's take a look and see how he lands here. There he is going through the air and takes a big flip and does come down, Tom, on that right shoulder.
Oh, you've got to be kidding me. Yep, In the first half, with the Browns up 28-7, defensive back Thane Gash went down after trying to break up a pass, landing on his head. And because of this injury, he was down on the field for a solid 10 minutes, and the stretcher had to be brought out. I am not repeating any footage. I am not slowing any tapes down. And I am not using any fancy editing tricks whatsoever. This is in real time, and this was an incredibly lengthy delay, to the point where I can't show it all. By the time the ball hit the ground, to the time the next snap was taken, it took 9 minutes and 12 seconds. 9 minutes and 12 seconds to go from one play to the next. In other words, yeah, this game was not ending in under 3 hours. If you want a game to end in 3 hours, you can't go 10 minutes in between plays. The one thing that you couldn't have happen, sure enough, happened. And at 3:58:28, when NBC had to make the call now just 90 seconds away from Bengals kickoff, they decided that even though the Browns were up by 18 points, being outside of the range that NBC previously said where they flip, that they were not going to flip. They changed their mind. The potential wrath of Browns fans if they flipped, especially since Tampa was on the 5-yard line, was too much to handle. They didn't want to risk a Heidi situation. If you want to learn more about the Heidi game, click the card in the upper right corner. And this meant that they stuck with the conclusion of the Browns game, as the Browns won it 42-31. And they stuck all the way through, even through Bernie Kosar's kneel downs. The problem? At 3:58:28, right when the Bengals game was about to kick off, the Browns-Buccaneers game still had 10 minutes left to go. That lengthy delay with the Gash injury didn't help things at all. And this meant that by the time the Browns game ended, it was 4:30 in the afternoon. That game took 3.5 hours to complete. And by the time that Channel 22 was finally able to go to Los Angeles for the Bengals-Raiders game to watch the team in their secondary market play, and the team that the NFL made them contractually obligated to show, it was already the second quarter. They didn't just miss a few plays. Bengals fans in Dayton, an hour outside of Cincinnati, missed the entire first quarter of action. And none of the announcers or production team members knew what was happening in Dayton. So at no point did they ever show a replay of what they missed, or inform the fans about what happened. And that was big, seeing as while they were gone in those first 30 minutes, a lot of stuff happened. Starting quarterback Boomer Esiason got hurt. Starting running back Eric Ball got hurt. The Bengals were down 14-0, and Bo Jackson pulled off one of the greatest runs in NFL history, and one of the best of his career, when he took it 92 yards to the house, completely untouched because he was so fast. Kind of important information there that Bengals fans just did not know about because of Channel 22 and their decision to be bullied by Browns fans. As Pete Salkowski, the director at the channel, said on Everything, "I doubt if the guys doing the game in Los Angeles even knew about us. They just naturally think all the home stations would be with them from the start." And yeah, he's got a point. And to say that Bengals fans were irate about this would be an understatement, especially since their mood did not get any better after watching the rest of the game, which was a brutal 28-7 loss to knock them out of first place of their division. They were down 28-0 at the end of the three quarters, so it wasn't even that close. There were 10 phone lines coming into the newsroom at Channel 22. Every single line was lit up. It wasn't until an hour afterwards that things finally died down a bit. But at their peak, the comments were bad. Salkowski said that it was like trying to please a pack of wild dogs. Some callers pretended that they were sponsors and said that they were going to pull their spots off the station because of this. Some went as far as issuing death threats. And Salkowski said on the whole incident with Bengals fans, our secretaries were offended by some of the comments. The whole thing got way out of hand. If we could get people this fired up over our homeless and educational system, imagine what we could do. With Salkowski not realizing that buying new textbooks for the children isn't going to help me win my fantasy matchup this week. Look, NBC and Channel 22 were in a rough spot with this one. There are Browns and Bengals fans in Dayton, and no matter what they did, there was going to be outrage. But the fact that Bengals fans thought they were getting their game, then the station said they would get it if it was outside of 17 points when 4 o'clock hit, then the station kept the Browns on anyways, even though the game was outside of 17 points when 4 o'clock hit, that made them understandably irate, because surely, even though this was a tough spot, there had to be a better way to communicate the issue at hand. The decision of whether or not a network or an affiliate should switch away from a game is always a tough one to make, especially in this situation. But perhaps no network and affiliate had it tougher than the NBC affiliate at Dayton in 1989. Because even though Sam Weish said later in the season to Bengals fans, "You don't live in Cleveland," based on what they ended up showing, NBC thought otherwise. Get your official Jaguar Gator 9 merchandise by going to jg9shop.com, and be sure to like this video, ring the notification bell, and subscribe down below if you haven't already, as it helps the channel out a lot. And be sure to check out Twitch every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern for your chance to play NFL trivia and win cash prizes. Link in the description below. If you want to see videos like this condensed down to 60 seconds, then follow me on TikTok at JaguarGator9. To see college football videos, subscribe to Jaguar Gator 8. To see highlight videos of players throughout the history of the NFL, subscribe to JG9 Highlights. Also, special thanks to all of our Patreon supporters for helping out the channel. Your support is greatly appreciated. So you can become a patron and request future video topics in the description below.